I'm a big fan of barred rocks. They're some of the very first chicks that I hatched out when I decided that I was going to start breeding chickens, and they are really wonderful birds. So we're gonna talk about all the reasons why barred rocks are so awesome and why I personally find them really great to have in my flock. My barred rocks are some of my friendliest chickens. Now, my chickens aren't super friendly. I don't tend to go out and pick them up and things like that because they're all hen raised. But my barred rocks are the ones that will come up when we're outside and really get involved in whatever I'm doing. They know where I am, they come find me. Skipper is one of my barred rock hens, and she comes out whenever I'm in the garden, and she comes and eats the worms and just generally gets in the way. So I always know if I'm gonna head out with a shovel, Skipper will be there in a hurry, knowing what I'm doing. My head flock rooster, my main mature rooster, is also a barred rock, and that is Kowalski. And he is a wonderful rooster. He looks after his hens, and he has some really nice babies. So barred rocks as roosters are a really good choice, especially if you haven't had roosters in your flock before. I have two more barred rock hens, and they are Bertha and Edna. And Bertha is a real character. What she likes to do is whenever we're sitting at the picnic table or something, she will come up and just peck at our clothes or our legs to get attention so we feed her food, much like a Labrador might do. And Edna, well, she's not quite as interesting as the other ones I've mentioned, but she does her job really well, and that is laying lots of eggs. So those are the barred rocks that I have in my flock. Most of my flock is not purebred barred rocks, and the reason for that is because I am working on a little breeding project, making my own sort of landrace chicken breed. But I've decided that barred rocks are the foundation of that breed that I am developing. So whilst most of my flock are not purebred barred rocks, most of them do have a percentage of barred rock in them, and I have found that to be a very good foundation for moving forward with where I'm going with that program. Talk a little bit about the history of the barred rock breed. Now, they were first mentioned, the very first mention of them was in 1849 at a poultry show in Boston. Now, this was at the very beginning of the chicken craze in the United States, and I have talked about that before. It was that crazy little period of time where everyone needed to have chickens, and it was where most of our modern heritage breeds came from. So 1849 in Boston, the first mention. Then they sort of disappear, it seems, for 20 years until they're at another show in 1869. And those are the birds that people consider that the modern barred rock breed comes from. So they've been around for a while, but like most breeds, not as long as you might think they have been. Barred rocks were the most popular breed kept in the United States before World War II, which is something I didn't know, and it's quite interesting. So why would barred rocks have been so popular? Well, they're a really great bird. They are what's known as a dual purpose bird, which means they are good for laying eggs, and they are also good as a table bird. And that makes them very useful and very popular in a time where we hadn't got these industrial specialized chickens that we have today. And I think they're a great choice today because we want to, well, in my opinion, we want to move away from those heavily bred industrial chickens and have a more natural and self-managing and all of those good things in our flocks, especially as a backyard flock. My barred rocks have been very healthy and a great addition. So from that perspective, they're a really hardy, helpful bird to have in your flock. Today, a lot of barred rocks have come from strains or bloodlines, whatever you want to call it, that have focused on exhibition and showing. So their focus on the ancestry of those birds hasn't really been on the utility, so the egg laying and the table qualities of those birds. So there's quite a lot of barred rock strains out there that are gorgeous, they're beautiful, they're perfect looking, but they're not particularly great at laying eggs. So if you're wanting to choose this breed for your backyard, it's worth doing some research, finding a breeder close to you rather than just willy-nilly finding one wherever they're advertised, and asking the question, do these birds actually perform? Have they been selected for their egg-laying abilities, if that's your target, or for growing well for the table, if that's your target? Like, what is their utility today? So here in New Zealand, a lot of barred rocks are very beautiful and pretty and massive and amazing, but they're not great at laying eggs. I made sure when I decided on barred rocks that I was going to get a good egg-laying strain, and I was really lucky in that one of the best breeders in the country lived really close to me. I could drive out and get hatching eggs from him, and I've been very, very happy with the birds that I got from those bloodlines. So worth doing your research, because not all barred rocks are the same. So what kind of performance can you expect from your barred rock hens? Well, in my flock with my egg-laying strain, I get about 200 eggs a year from each of my hens for the first 2 years that they lay. Now, you'll see different statistics all over the internet about how many eggs your birds are going to lay. I would always say, err on the side of caution, take the lower number. Most heritage breed birds shouldn't be expected to lay huge numbers of eggs, and you don't want them to lay huge numbers of eggs because it's not that great for their health, and it's not really their intended purpose. So under 200 eggs is good. 180 to 200 would be really good production, in my opinion, under a backyard situation. Of course, our modern production breeds can lay a lot more than that, so really keep in mind, if you're working out how many eggs you're going to get per year, that you have a realistic expectation of what a heritage breed like a barred rock can actually give you. There can be quite a few differences in breeds between countries. So here in New Zealand, we have closed genetics. So no birds have come into the country, chicken breeds, I mean, since the 1950s, which means that the breeds we have here can start to diverge from breeds in other countries. Now, from the perspective of barred rocks, I don't think that's happened too much, but here they tend to be very big, and I've seen in other countries that those birds are not necessarily as huge as our barred rocks are here. But again, you can probably find big ones and small ones because other countries often have many more birds and many more strains to choose from. So just something to keep in mind, that my experiences with barred rocks might not be the same as the sorts of barred rocks that you can find in your country. Some other differences I've seen is here, my barred rocks don't tend to go broody very often. It can happen, it has happened to me, but generally they don't go broody, at least not compared to most of my other chickens, which go broody like 3-4 times a year. My barred rocks have only gone broody one hen one time, one hen no times, and the other hen twice. So much less compared to some of the other breeds that I have. What does seem to be the same is that they are a very chill, easy bird. They get along with different breeds in the flock, and they're a great choice for a beginner. And another thing that seems to be pretty consistent is that the roosters are really cool dudes that tend to be just chill and easy to deal with and not aggressive. So I do want to talk about barred rock roosters for a little moment. In my experience and from all the research that I've done, you have a very good chance of getting an excellent rooster if you choose a barred rock for your rooster. A lot of breeds have a tendency to have a higher percentage of roosters that might be a little bit less easy to manage. When we're talking large breeds and chickens, the roosters often tend to be quite chilled dudes. Maybe it's just because they're so big, they get too lazy to really bother. I'm not sure, but it tends to be a theme. And barred rock roosters just tend to be super lovely guys. My rooster is wonderful. He lives here with lots of hens, lots of chicks in the hatching season, and multiple other roosters at times. His son is here as my second rooster, and they get along just fine with no drama. So if you're looking for a great rooster, I would highly recommend Barred Rock as an excellent choice. I'm a big fan of genetics and science and just really getting into the details of things. So I really did some deep dives into the genetics of barred rocks, particularly around the barring gene. So we'll get to that in a minute. We're going to do a big thing about genetics on the barring gene. But let's talk about some definitions. So barred rocks are what is known as an auto-sexing breed. And what that means is that you can tell whether you have girls or boys from the day that they hatch. And it gets easier and easier to tell the older they get, which is much, much, much earlier than most breeds, where you generally can't tell until they're 3 weeks old. I have a pretty good idea, but generally not till they're more like 5 or 6 weeks old. But in barred rocks, it's very easy to tell. So what happens when a barred rock hatches? Well, the girls have a very, very well-defined little spot on the top of their head, and they tend to have darker coloured legs. And the boys have sort of larger, messier spots on top of their head and lighter legs. So you need to use those two factors together to tell, and it does take a bit of practice, but if barred rock breeding is what you do, you'll get pretty good at knowing on day one. But if you can't tell, and I couldn't tell in the beginning either, I'm like, is it, isn't it? I was looking at photos on the internet and stuff. But if you can't tell, then by the time they start to get their wingtip feathers in, it's very easy to tell. And that's because boy barred rocks have two copies of the barring gene, and girl barred rocks only have one copy. And that means that the girl barred rocks have a darker color, so they have a fairly even black and white striping. And the cockerels, the boys, they have a double the white space, so their black lines are smaller than their white lines, so it makes them appear a lighter color, which is really easy to tell what you have. So by the time they're like a week old, 2 weeks at the most, you're going to know 100% what your ratio of girls to boys is. So that is what is known as an auto-sexing breed. There are other breeds you can do that with which have different characteristics, but for barred rocks, it comes from how the barring gene interacts between the male and the female. This works with other barred breeds as well, like Dominiques and things like that. And let's talk about just how that barring gene works and why it means that this is possible, and also why a barred hen can be used to create a sex link cross with a solid coloured rooster. In chickens, the hen can only ever have one copy of the barring gene. It is impossible for her to have two. And if you have a purebred barred breed, so a barred rock that is purebred, has barred rock parents all the way back, they are going to have two barred genes. Now, it's possible for a rooster to be barred and have only one gene, but then they wouldn't be a barred rock rooster. Now, if you have that double gene on the rooster and the single gene on the hen, when they have babies, that's going to carry through. They will still keep having the two for the boy, the one for the girl. Now, where you can start to use this concept for creating a sex link, so they're often called like a black sex link, because a barred rock hen will often create a black solid colored hen as her child, is you can get the barred rock hen or any barred breed hen with the one copy of the gene and a solid coloured rooster who does not have the barring gene, so that could be partridge or a buff or anything like that. And when they have babies, the girls will all hatch out solid coloured, and the boys will all hatch out with a barring gene, because the hen will always pass the barring gene to her sons. It is on the chromosome that sets the sex of the chicken, so the hen has no choice but to pass the barring gene to her sons and a solid gene to her daughters. Which means you can tell at hatch whether you have girls or boys, because the boys will have a little spot on their head indicating that they are going to have barred plumage, and the girls will be solid coloured, which is really handy. You can't create a purebred strain with this strategy, but it's really handy for backyard breeding or producing chickens for production laying, because you know at hatch what they're going to be. I have done this myself. I have a hen, her name is Nyx, and she's cruising around, and her mother was Bertha, I believe. And her father was a partridge rock rooster that I had a couple of years ago. And so together they made that sex link. And when she hatched out, I could see she was a hen. Yay, I had a hen. And she was the only hen that I got from that. The rest were boys, but I knew they were boys on day one because they were barred. So it's a really great way to know whether you have girls or boys, because that is a factor and it's hard to tell, and you need to plan ahead for what you're gonna do for all those extra boys. I really, really enjoy having my barred rocks in my flock, and I look forward to seeing how those genetics move forward in my flock over time. If you're thinking about adding them to your flock, I think they're a great choice. If you're a fan of big chickens that are pretty chill and look awesome, they're an awesome choice, and like I've said, an excellent choice for a rooster if you're gonna have roosters in your flock. I love them. I think you'll love them too. I hope you have a good experience if you decide to get barred rocks too.